Joe Ellen, it was Masters, now it's Smith.
And then can you tell us which years did you attend Linda McKinley? How old were you in 71 and what grade were you in?
I attended Linda McKinley for my final 3 years of high school. I graduated in 71. So when I graduated, I was 18.
Okay. And can you talk about just your background up to the time that you began school at Linda McKinley? Were you living in the Linden area all your life, or did your family move there?
We lived in the Linden McKinley, or in the Linden area, for about 5 years, I think. So we had moved there a couple of years previous.
Okay, and where were you before that?
The south end of Columbus, actually.
Okay. So, as a young person, were you aware of political and social turmoil that was happening in the country at large and during that time, particularly late 60s and into 71? And what were your thoughts and your feelings?
There was a lot of social unrest in the country in the 60s, and it was confusing. I mean, I saw it on TV. We didn't read the newspapers much. I was kind of on my own little world going to school and things, but it was confusing. I wasn't sure about it all. It was very sad, you know, when we lost Dr. Martin Luther King, so it seemed like a lot of things were happening all at once, and similar to now, you never knew what to expect the next day. So yeah, it was kind of confusing and sometimes sad.
And can you talk a little bit about your family if you're comfortable?
Sure, I guess. Well, I had two parents, one sister, she was younger. We lived in the area, well, in different parts of the area of Columbus and outlying areas for my whole life. We didn't live out of state. I don't know if there's anything particularly special about that.
Well, when we talked before, you mentioned, with regard to just kind of perspectives, you mentioned your father.
Oh, yeah.
And his feelings. And so I wondered if you might talk a little bit about that and how his feelings affected or didn't affect you.
Yeah, I would describe my dad more of as a bigot. He was not a man to be proud of in that respect at all. So when I went to Linda McKinley as a high school student, I wanted to date. But some of the guys that I wanted to date, my faith was important to me. So I was looking for, you know, someone who had the same faith as me. And a lot of the guys that I would have been interested in, of course, weren't quite enough for him. My dad, that is. So there is no way. I could never, ever, ever have disobeyed him on that one, because there's kind of violence in our home, and it was not good. You couldn't say no to this guy. So that was sad, because I kind of held me back, because I kind of really wanted to be more involved if I could have been, but yeah. My mother, on the other hand, if I can add this, I don't know how this will be taken, but the first time when I was very small, I rode the city bus with her. We're talking the 60s, and actually the 50s that would have been. My first time on a city bus, but I had seen it, and I had seen kids sitting on the back row, looking out the back window, waving when we were in our car, and I thought, I want to do that. I want to get in that back row seat so you can see, because the other windows were too high for me to see out of. So when we got on the bus, and my mom put the money in, and we got on, and I started to race to the back of the bus for that special seat. She said, "Oh, honey, we can't sit back there. Those are reserved for very special people." And in hindsight, I didn't understand. I told her I wanted to be special, but now looking back on it, I was glad she explained it that way. And because those were the days, you know, when unfortunately segregated part of our population into the back of the bus, and I was glad she explained it that way.
That's a great story. Thank you for sharing that. So can you talk about changes in the Linden community while you were there, while you were a student there, whether it's starting with junior high or even before that through high school? How did the racial makeup of the community change?
Well, I wasn't there too long. 5 years isn't very long to watch a community change. So I don't know what it had been. But the community itself, I don't know the statistics, but it seemed mostly white. But there was beginning to be some crime. My dad's car was nearly stolen out of our driveway. He ran and flagged them down. They popped it into gear and were rolling it down the highway. We had just little crimes like that, but nothing else. It seemed like a nice community.
And when you did you notice at some point in high school, were there more black families moving to Linden? And was that reflected in the school?
I don't know if there were more black families moving into Linden area at any particular time. I didn't notice that. I don't know. And in the school, I'm not sure. It just seemed like we were... I don't know. There was it seemed like there was maybe, I don't know, half the population black, half white. I don't know. I'm not sure. And I don't know if that increased or not. I have no idea. I didn't notice. I'm sorry.
That's okay. No. There are no wrong answers. While you were a student at the school, were you aware of racial tension? And as a white student, were you aware of that? Were you aware of tension? And also, were you aware of black students being treated differently?
Unfortunately, as far as racial tension in our high school, I wasn't aware of anything until my senior year. It seemed like that was the year when everything seemed to come to a head. I wasn't aware of anything. Evidently, there was. Last night I was reviewing some of my articles that I had saved from high school, and there was an article from a year from 1969, and they were interviewing students. Students were interviewed in this dispatch article about racism in the school, and it all seemed quite positive. So I just don't. Yeah, I did not notice anything particular. And as far as black people being treated any differently, I didn't notice that either. But I was probably just a self-absorbed teenager, I'm thinking.
Okay, fair enough. So beyond that, there were a group of black students who felt like things were unfair and they wanted to change things that they thought were unjust at the school. They wanted, at a point when there were a significant number of black students, they wanted to have that represented in the school and have curriculum that reflected that and to not be subject to harsher punishments, which they felt was happening. Did you know these students and, you know, the group that met regularly at John Wells' house? And what were your thoughts? What were your memories of
I didn't know about any of that going on at all. I didn't know about a group at John Wells' house until now. I didn't know anything. I didn't even sense an undercurrent really too much until my senior year, an undercurrent of unrest. But yeah, I didn't know about the specifics. I was confused about that.
Go ahead. No, go ahead. I'm sorry.
You asked who I knew who was involved in that. I found out a little bit later that my classmate, Valora Washington, was, but she never explained. We worked on the newspaper together, but I don't remember her ever explaining that what she was going through or dealing with, or that was on her mind and what she needed, that things needed to change. She never explained that, and maybe it was because I was white. I don't know. You know, maybe she wasn't comfortable explaining that to me. I don't think we knew each other well enough either for that. I mean, we were friends at school, but that was about it.
And when we talked before, one of the times we talked, you mentioned an incident with the art teacher, Mr. Byers.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. Every time I think of his name, I smile because he was just a likable person. You have to picture him. He was a little short black dude with black-rimmed glasses. He made you toe the mark in art class. I was an art major, and he made you compete. He made you work hard, and I liked him, and I think everybody did. But one day, during some of this unrest, when it was at the end of the year, there was a group of students coming towards our art classroom because the doors were always open, and they looked intimidating, and I can't remember why they seemed intimidating to me, you know. But when they got in the classroom, we were all hiding behind Mr. Byers, and we were taller than him. And he looked nervous, but the students wanted poster board and paint to make posters and brushes, maybe. I don't remember. But he gave them what they wanted, and they left. There was no violence or anything. They just seemed like they were on a mission, okay?
And did you know any of those students who came for the art supplies?
No, I didn't know any of them.
Gotcha. Before we get to, you mentioned Valora Washington, and so I was going to ask you if you could talk a little bit about your friendship with her and if it changed during your senior year, and you could maybe, you know, describe what that was like.
Yeah, we were somewhat friends. I don't even know if she remembers me because maybe I thought more of her than she did of me. I don't know, but we were friends and worked on the school newspaper. I had I do remember an incident where I saw some of her friends pressuring her to get an afro. She was straightening her hair still at that point, and they were riding her and saying, "Well, are you black or are you white? Where's your afro?" And the next time I saw her, because we didn't have classes for quite a while at the end during the turmoil, and when we went back for exams, I saw Valora with her friends. And she had a big afro, as long as her friends did, too. And I said, "Hi, how are you doing?" And she completely ignored me, purposely. So I felt sad. I felt sad that that relationship was probably gone. And but I don't know. I felt sad for her, too, because she was pressured. No, she should have had the choice to do with her hair whatever she wanted to do, I guess, but I don't know. It was sad. I have no other word for it.
Did it surprise you?
I guess a little bit. It shouldn't have, I guess, but it did surprise me.
And did you have other black friends while you were at Lyndon McKinley? And what about outside of school? What were your friends group like? Your friend groups like outside of school?
I had other black friends at Lyndon McKinley. I don't know if I'm supposed to give names or not, but yes, I did. One girl in particular, we had lunch with her almost every day, and her name was Tina, and I loved her. I've been in touch with her recently even, so. I didn't have a lot of friends, so I guess I was too selective, but I didn't have a lot of friends, but the ones I had, you know, I respected, and I respected Tina a lot. She was on the National Honor Society, and but gentle. She had such a warm heart. My other group of friends, I went to a church, also sort of in the Linden area on the border. It was on Pontiac Street, and those friends... That church was mostly white. I don't think we had any black people, unfortunately, and I could probably tell you why, because our pastor really tried to preach sermons and have Bible studies to help us, help the white people in our church to be kinder and more open-minded, and it wasn't working for some of them, I could tell. So, no, I hung out with I was mostly at church all the time, though. That really kept me out of my house, and so when I wasn't at school, I was usually at church.
I see. Okay, so let's shift gears a little bit, and I'm going to ask you about Charles Ross and your memories of him at Lyndon McKinley. If you could talk a little bit about that.
Well, my memories of him... I don't remember ever seeing him. I may have and didn't know it. But I thought he was having classes there, or started anyway. And when they showed a film to one of our classes that had been shown in I don't know what it was, Black Studies class or something before school started, they showed one of the films that had been shown in that class to mainstream school. I don't know what class I was in. And in one of the scenes, a black doctor went in to examine a white female teenager, and when he opened her gown, of course all the girls in the class gasped. And I was told later that they were told in that class to watch our reaction to that, because if we gasped, then that meant that we were prejudiced. And I thought, really? I would have gasped if he was, just because he was a man, primarily. I would have preferred a female doctor. And so it was confusing. I didn't know. It almost looked like, at that time, it looked like I didn't care for Dr. Ross very much. It looked like he was sowing fascism or something. Now when I look back, fortunately, you know, I can see a lot more. I've learned a lot more, thank goodness. I didn't know what people were suffering with, and maybe some people had, you know, had experiences that I did not. But my mom had always told me that if you ever get a black doctor, you better keep him, because he had to work really extra hard to get to that place. In the 50s and 60s, he did. And so he probably really knew his stuff. And at one time, she had been very, very sick, and she finally got a black doctor, or I'm not going to say a black doctor. She finally found a doctor that was helping her, finally. I mean, she was very sick. And he was black, and when my dad found out he was black, he forbade her to see him again. So, and that was sad, because my mom's health deteriorated after.
Wow. thank you for sharing that. That's interesting too, because my mother was a doctor.
Oh yeah.
And yeah, I mean, and so it's interesting. I mean, having grown up with her and seeing, at least, you know, as much as I could be aware as a child of challenges that she faced, being Black and a woman, you know, at the time when she was usually the only one of either, you know, in terms of doctors where she was. So let's go into 1971. And in February, there was the Black History Week performance where there was a disruptive incident. So I wondered, were you there for the performance? And did you see what happened? And if you could just talk us through what you know of about that incident.
The Black History performance, I don't think I was there for that. I don't remember it. Maybe I blocked it, but I don't remember it at all. I've been told what happened, and I totally believe everything I've been told. And it's funny, that brought up something that I had forgotten about when you asked that question. It's like, oh, I remember there was an honor assembly. During Black History Month, they wanted people to write, I don't know, it was just poems or prose or whatever they wanted them to write, essays, and there was a competition and they'd be given an award for it. Well, I wrote a poem from the eyes, supposedly, of Martin Luther King Jr.'s little boy. And I won first prize. And when I, as a little white girl, walked up there to collect the award, and it was named something about Daddy, I can't remember the other name of it, but everybody laughed. and I didn't, now looking back on it, I'm wondering, how did I get that? Did I get that because, was it good? Or was because I was white? I mean, I don't know. It made me wonder after that. But anyway, my heart was in it. Anyway, regardless.
Do you still have the poem?
Somewhere. I was going to look for it, and I never did.
Wow. So when you went to get it and people laughed, how did you feel?
I didn't.
It was funny as well. Were you expecting to win?
I was hoping, but no, I wasn't expecting. I was hoping, but I was good at writing, and I was good, you know, I was good in theater, and I got Actress of the Year award for my junior play. So, yeah, I like that kind of stuff, but I wasn't expecting it. I mean, I was looking forward to it, and it was when they laughed, I didn't care. I was the one with the award, so I didn't care if they were laughing at me. I thought they were probably just laughing because I was white and the name of the poem just didn't line up with what they were expecting to see.
Sorry, if you do find it, please let me know.
Oh, okay.
I'd be curious to see it, for sure. And so what were you, if you don't remember whether you were there, you said that you heard what happened, you were told what happened, and you believed it. So can you expand on that a little bit? What were you told, and why did you believe what you were told?
Because my friends told me, who were there. My friend Tina, who I referred to before, she had been there. She gave me a dramatic, I guess things really. She said she couldn't remember. I'm not supposed to tell her story, I guess, but she said it was crazy and that it led to, and she couldn't remember if it was that same day or the next day, where the police were in the halls telling everybody to get out of the school, but the police were blocking the doors and they couldn't get out. And she said, well, how are we supposed to get out? And the policeman evidently told her, I don't know, throw a window. So that's what they did. And they were scared. They didn't know what was going on. So that was her experience. That's what I was told. And that was sad.
What did she say happened in the auditorium during the play?
She explained. Oh, okay. She said in the auditorium at the play, evidently flyers were dumped from the balcony, and I guess they were racist. I don't know what they said. I never saw one. And I guess that started some tensions boiling, as it would. I'm sure it would. And then I was told that it got all confusing from there, and the kids were running around like crazy, and it was chaos.
And were you, even if you weren't there, did you sense a change in the school after February?
Probably. Maybe that's when I first started sensing it. Yeah, because it was into the year somewhat. Yeah. It's an undercurrent, and I didn't know what it was all about. And I wish I did at the time, but I didn't.
So, were you aware of a march that happened on May 19th to celebrate Malcolm X's birthday, when there were a number of black students who marched from Linda McKinley to Franklin Park?
I found out by reading the newspaper. Our school was on the front page, and our students were leading the way on that. And I saw the pictures in the newspaper, but I didn't know it was being planned or anything. I don't know anything about the flag. I know some students were talking about that the school should be named Malcolm X School or something. Something different than what it was.
Yeah. On the day of the march, were you at school?
I don't think so, because I don't remember that. Okay. I only remember seeing the newspaper.
And when you saw the article in the paper, were you surprised?
Well, yeah, my friends were right there on the front page. I was surprised, but not unexpected, I guess. So I guess I had been feeling it was something was happening.
Okay, so then let's move forward a little bit into May and talk about the flag. Were you present when the flag was switched? Did you ever see the red, black, and green flag flying in front of Linda McKinley? And can you talk about that and also what happened in the aftermath with the police coming to the school? Were you present for that when the police raid happened?
I don't think I was at school when that happened with the flag, when the flag was switched out. And I don't think I was at school for the raid, or I just don't remember. I know there was one point when I was in a class, like on one of the other floors, and we could hear turmoil, but that's all I knew. I don't know what was going on at the time. We stayed in our classes. So, I don't have an experience with that.
So, you talked about making announcements in the morning, and I believe this was the day after the flag was switched. And in the morning, you had a student partner, who did the announcements with you, and you talked about your partner leaving the door open so that other students could come in to make an announcement, and that Mr. Titus questioned you. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it was Miss Titus. And
no, Miss Titus.
Yes. Yes, I was on a team to, since I was in speech class, I was on a team that did the announcements in the morning, and Miss Titus had called us to her office before the announcements this particular morning. And she said, I have heard a rumor that someone's going to try to call an unlawful assembly Do either of you know anything about that? I definitely didn't. The boy that was with me didn't not know, or he said he didn't know. We made the announcements and we were exiting, and this door was kept locked and only certain people were allowed in at a time. It was a very small little studio, and as we left, my partner, there were people waiting right outside the door. There were students waiting, and he just held the door open for them and let them in. So I thought, oh boy, he's in big trouble.
Did you recognize the students who were waiting outside?
No, no.
And did you hear them make an announcement after that?
I could hear it reverberating through the school. I think I may have left school at that point and walked home. I don't know. I don't remember staying for the assembly for sure.
Do you remember what you heard?
No. I must have blocked it all out. I can't remember what it was. I just remember it must have been something that I knew wasn't supposed to happen. And the hall started to get crazy with kids not knowing what to do. Do we go to our classes? Do we go to this assembly? What's going on? There was mass confusion. So, and that's where my memory ends. Sorry.
No, that's fine. So do you think what you heard was the reason that you went home?
Yes, oh, definitely. I think I went home. Either that or I had to have, because nobody knew what to do. You either went to the assembly or what did you do? Go to class? Or was anybody going to be in? I don't know. So that's why I'm assuming I went home.
Okay, and so I have a note here. When we talked about this before, you made a statement that you were upset about the way that the police treated students. And I know that you said when we talked the first time that you thought that it was important for this story to be told, and that you tried to get the dispatch to cover it years ago. Mm-hmm. So can you talk a little bit about that? What was it that the police did that you found upsetting? And what was it about the story? What story did you think needed to be told? What did you want the dispatch to cover?
Well, first of all, school ended abruptly. I mean, first we're going to school, then it was the social unrest, the racial unrest was happening, and it was confusion, and all of a sudden there was no more school. So it was like reading a good book, and you just get to the exciting part, and it just ends. So there was no closure. We couldn't figure out what happened, what was going on. I didn't know. So I went to a reunion after the fact, and that's when in one of our one of the reunions we were talking in a small group about what was happening at the end, and students had brought their newspaper clippings, and then they were telling their stories about what happened that day to them. And evidently police stormed the school and were hitting, from what I understood, hitting students over the head with their batons and dragging them out if they were black. It didn't matter if they were the activists or not. It didn't matter that they were just mistreated. These were students. We're talking a high school. Kids are ages, 14 to 18? I just couldn't believe that some of my friends that were standing there with me, you know, witnessed this or were hurt. And they lived through it, and that was unjust.
Thank you for sharing that. Can you talk a little bit about how your experiences at Lyndon McKinley, what you learned after, how that has affected you, you know, in your life after high school?
I think my experiences helped me to become more open-minded, to listen, to ask questions, to stand up for people that are having a hard time, that are being treated unjustly, whoever they are. I think that's how it helped me. It's funny, I just popped into my mind, I did go into the ministry after that. I left the area right away and worked in Cincinnati, Cincinnati first, then Kentucky, and then went directly to Bible college after that. And I was really interested in the social things that were going on and how to be a part of resolving that, because the ministry I went into was with the Salvation Army, and they're always for helping everybody, so... Yeah, I think it might have made me more compassionate and more, maybe wake me up and say, pay attention, what's going on in the world and with your people that you know.
And would you say that that is still the case today?
Oh, yeah, of course, of course. Yeah. Always there for the underdog or the person who's not being treated well. Yeah, I can't give you any good examples.
Well, that's okay. I wonder,
Well, I guess I can. I just realized I volunteer with NAMI, National Alliance on Mental Illness, and so I do support groups for people, and there's so many higher rates of, like, suicide for marginalized people. And you just gotta know what questions to ask and to watch people and to see if they need help and to, you know, refer them to the right resources and just to listen. Yeah, I think with NAMI, doing support groups with them has been, is a part of that in a way.
Would you say that your own personal experiences growing up with your dad, has made you more sensitive to others being mistreated?
Yes, it probably has. He was a bully. He was a lot of things. He was a lot worse than a bully, but I'm not going to go into that. But yes, definitely. People are, because I knew what it was like to be mistreated. Grew up in an abusive household, so I understood that. And I understood what it's like not to have people believe you or to think they won't.
I see. So, and is there anything that you would like to add? Is there anything that we talked about that you wanted to expand on, or anything that we didn't talk about that you want to address?
Well, the only thing I wanted to end on is I wanted to make sure, back when I attended that, when I found out from my classmates how they'd been treated, you know, this is after the fact at a reunion, that's when I thought, well, everybody should know that our class suffered through this. And at the time, we had the superintendent of Columbus Public Schools was one of our classmates, and the world needs to know that this happened. I mean, they think they've got it bad now. Well, they ought to see what our classmates suffered through, what we all suffered through. There were losses on, everybody had losses from there. We didn't know, I guess that's why what's going on with COVID and when the kids didn't get to have graduations reminded me of my graduation we almost didn't have because of social unrest and we didn't know if we were going to have a graduation. And I was kind of looking forward to it because I got to audition for one of the, to do the commencement meditation, and I was given the opportunity to do that. So I was kind of looking forward to doing that at my graduation. But more important, I wanted my school to be safe too. And yeah, but it did happen. We finally did graduate. It was changed up a little bit, but we did it. But that story needs to be told, and I'm glad you're telling it. I'm glad someone's telling this story now.
Well, we appreciate you being a part of this and giving your voice to the story and your perspective.